lineup tonight. I'm very excited about this. We're focusing on the flu tonight. So first up, we're going to have Nicole Bouvier. Nicole studies host viral and environmental factors that affect influenza virus transmission. She received her MD from Mount Sinai with a distinction in research, which means she got her MD and also did research as well, which is really impressive. And following doing a postdoc and some clinical fellowship, she became an assistant professor of microbiology and infectious disease at Mount Sinai. So she's not only doing research, she's also practicing medicine at Mount Sinai, and so she's doing it all. But most impressive is she got her bachelor in studio art. So she went from doing studio art, and now she's just killing it in science and being a physician. So let's all welcome Nicole. She's going to give us a talk on the flu.
I'm Nicole, and I think I don't need to say anything more about who I am, because that was a lovely introduction. Okay, let's get it a little closer. How's that? Okay, so yes, I was a reformed art major, which is why my PowerPoint is full of animations, just because I can't let that part of me go. So I have to stand next to the computer so I can keep hitting the enter key. So what I'm going to do is start off with some of the basics, just to make sure that everybody's on the same page about what influenza is and what we know about how it transmits. So if anyone has any questions, feel free to interrupt me. And if you already know what I'm about to say, just drink or something until I get to the more interesting parts. All right, so, and I'm also going to make you do a little audience participation. So, what is influenza?
A virus.
It is a virus. It is the flu. Anything else?
Terrible.
What?
Terrible.
It is terrible. It is terrible.
Contagious.
It is contagious. It is a virus?
I don't know if that's the right terminology, but there are multiple strains.
Oh, there are. Yes, there are. It's a human pathogen. It's a chicken pathogen and a wild bird pathogen and pigs and dogs and, well, cats. There was just a big flu outbreak in the animal shelter, the ACC animal shelter up in Harlem. But what it is, most of all, is a disease. So in proper terminology, influenza is the disease that is caused by influenza viruses. Now, who here has had influenza? Okay, those of you who haven't raised your hands, either you're delusional or you were too young and don't remember it. Because if I were to test any of your blood and look for flu antibodies, I would find it. And not only because you've been vaccinated, because we know that vaccine antibodies don't actually last that long, but if you were roaming this earth, say in 1990, if I tested your blood for flu strains that were circulating in that time, I would find evidence that you'd been infected by them. So pretty much everybody gets infected all of the time. And what happens to us? So basically the flu disease is a combination of respiratory symptoms, which is mainly coughing, runny nose, congestion, sore throat, things that are directly referable to the respiratory tract. And then what makes it so terrible is what we call the systemic symptoms. And those are the sort of generalized awfulness that you experience when you have the flu. It's things like headaches, body aches, fever, chills, you don't wanna eat, you can't get out of bed, you feel like you got hit by a truck. That's influenza. And what differentiates influenza from, say, a common cold is those really systemic symptoms that are what is so bad. Like, coughing in the flu isn't so bad. It's the fact that you feel so awful when you have it. So this is me with the flu a couple years ago. So this was MLK weekend of 2015, where I spent my 3-day weekend in bed, having gotten the flu. And you can see, I have some, it's hard to see, but I have like sweat on my forehead because my fever is so high. And I actually took some pictures of the thermometer because I couldn't remember the last time I had a fever. And that was despite having gotten a vaccine, because I am a healthcare professional, and like all healthcare professionals in New York State, I must be vaccinated against influenza, or I have to wear a mask anytime I'm anywhere in the hospital where I'm near a patient. So you can see, I actually did get vaccinated that year, and I got flu anyway. Now, why the vaccine doesn't work so great is an entirely separate topic, which I am happy to discuss if anyone wants to talk about it later. It's too much for this forum. But how is flu so contagious? How do we actually get the flu? How do you think you get the flu when you get it from somebody else?
French yeast.
Possible. Talking to somebody?
Not washing your hands.
Not washing your hands well enough?
Taking the subway.
Taking the subway?
Respiratory droplets.
Uh-huh. That was the more scientific answer. I like that.
What did he say?
Respiratory droplets. You know, subway, respiratory droplets. Well, the fact of the matter is we actually are not entirely sure how we get the flu. We are not sure how we get it. So when you're talking about how people get respiratory infections, it helps to have a framework to think about how the pathogen actually enters into you. And so this is the framework that I like. It was established by the CDC. And basically what it does is it separates the modes of transmission into contact-based and airborne-based. And so for the contact-based, you have what's called direct contact and indirect contact. So direct contact means that your hands get directly contaminated with flu from somebody else's nose. So you're the mother who's helping your kid blow their nose, and you get some flu on your nose, on your hand, and then you rub your nose, and that's how you get it. Indirect contact involves what we call a fomite. That's an inanimate object that gets contaminated by somebody else, like somebody rubs their nose. Yeah. So it depends on what the surface is. There's been some study. This question is, how long does flu live on a surface? And there's been some experiments done actually a long time ago, like back in the 80s, where some scientists put flu on some various items and found that it lasted longest on stainless steel. So hard surfaces could recover flu up to, I think, a day or two later. And it lasted hardly long at all on porous surfaces like cloth, tissue paper, anything that absorbs it. It seemed to last for like hours at the most. Now, this is totally artificial. It's basically taking some flu that's suspended in some saline solution and putting in a big droplet on a surface, which is really not how it happens. You've got snot and other things that, probably affect the longevity of flu, but that's sort of a ballpark, okay? If you have, say, flu on this doorknob, you touch the doorknob, the flu's still viable, you touch your nose. Basically, both of these methods involve your hand getting contaminated with live flu, and then you put it in your own nose. Okay? So that's the contact side. Now let's talk about the airborne side. So there's something called droplet spray and then something called aerosol. Now, droplet spray is exactly what you expect. Somebody sneezes, and you have the misfortune to be sneezed upon. So that is flu in the respiratory secretions of some person flying out of their nose and mouth and impacting directly on your nasal mucosa, and you get infected, okay? There's also something called aerosol, which is a little bit harder to explain, but it also involves flu coming out of somebody because they are sneezing or coughing or talking or even just breathing. We are constantly breathing out stuff from inside of our respiratory tract. There's proteins, broken down cells, there's surfactants from your lung, there's all kinds of things that you're always breathing out. And when you have flu becomes one of the things that you're always breathing out. And what happens is, because your respiratory tract is like really humidified, it's like 100% humidity in there, everything is drenched. As soon as you exhale this out into the air, it starts to dry. So you could have a nice big juicy droplet of something. And as soon as it gets out in the air, it's gonna start to desiccate. And the question is, does it desiccate faster than it falls to the ground? Is it big enough that it can fall fast enough that before it dries out, it hits the ground? Or is it gonna slowly evaporate in the air and become light enough to stay in the air? And that's called an aerosol. So when something is light enough that it's more buoyant than, I guess the force of the air keeping it up is more than the force of gravity trying to bring it down. Okay, does that make sense? So what we're talking about is you know, this sick person has all of these particles around them that are drying out at certain rates. And it's not so much we're talking about the person who's standing right in front of him. We're talking about the person who's sort of far away. And as this particle that the virus is in starts drying out and becomes light enough to be floating on air, it can move with air currents and go over and infect a person who's not even close to you. It may be even a person who came into the room after you're gone, but your flu virus is still hanging there in the air just waiting for them, okay? So these are sort of the four modes that I'm going to be referring to when I'm talking about flu transmission. So how would we potentially decide what is more important for flu? How do we decide amongst these? We do experiments, okay? And who do you want to do experiments in? Ideally, people. Exactly. Because we're people, that's who we care about. Well, I mean, I care about cats and stuff. I'm sorry that the cat shelter had flu, but as a physician, I have to say, you know, I care about people. So how do we study this? So one way of studying it is doing what's called a household study. So somebody gets sick, you know, this little girl has the misfortune of getting flu out in the community, and her mom takes her to the pediatrician, and the pediatrician diagnoses flu, and then he or she also says, hey, we have a study going on. Would you like to enroll your family in the study? And then what you do is you send them home with some sort of intervention and see, do other people in the family get sick from this index case, this sick girl, or not? Okay, that makes sense? So in this particular study that I'm talking about, what they did is they randomized each household to three interventions. Okay, the first one was sort of business as usual. This was the control group. They just said, go home and do what you normally do. Take care of your kid the way you would normally take care of them. Don't do anything special. Just be. The second group was what was called the hand hygiene group. So these families were actually given soap, and every person in the family had their own personal hand sanitizer, and they got education as to the importance of hand hygiene and preventing disease transmission. And then they were sent back onto their homes, and that was that group. The third group was the surgical mask group. So this group was given, everyone in the house was given a box of surgical masks, and they were given some education about the importance of masks in preventing disease transmission, and then they were sent back home, okay? So the principle behind these three groups is that in the sort of control group, any of these four theoretical modes are possible, okay? This little girl, I mean, her mom could be blowing her nose and get flu by direct contact, or the girl could touch something that her mom then touches and then brings it to her nose, and that's indirect contact. The girl could sneeze in her mom's face, or they can just be, you know, spending some time together and the girl's breathing out flu into the air and the mother inhales in an aerosol, okay? So this is the group where anything is possible. The hand hygiene group, theoretically, if you are doing really thorough hand hygiene, you're killing the flu virus on your hands before you have a chance to auto-inoculate. So by, you know, frequently washing your hands, frequently using hand sanitizer, things like that, ideally, this group is going to be the group in which contact modes are sort of less important. And then what that does is say that any transmissions that occur in these households are probably by one of the airborne routes, okay? The last group, you could sort of imagine how a surgical mask would cut down on droplet spray transmission, because if you've got a mask on and somebody sneezes in your face, it's going to hit the mask instead of hitting your nose, okay? But you can also sort of imagine that it's probably going to cut down on direct and indirect contact as well, because if you've got a mask on, you're not touching your nose, okay? And human beings touch their noses like hundreds of times a day. You do not even realize how many times you touch your face and touch your nose until somebody shows you a video of you doing it. And then that's when you realize it's kind of crazy. So what the mask does is it prevents you from doing that. So theoretically, at least, the only way that the people in the surgical mask group are going to get infected is by aerosol. And that's because these masks are not fastened to your face. You know, they kind of have gaps in them. Aerosols can sort of go in around the gaps. You know, the weave of the mask is not so dense that, you know, a small aerosol can just get sucked right through that weave, okay? It's not like a respirator or anything. So at least in theory, this is the group that can only get infected by aerosol transmission. And so what do you think the results of the study was?
Just before we go into the results, how did you actually make sure that these people actually used these?
Okay, you're getting ahead of me. It's a good question, but this wasn't actually my study, this was somebody else's.
How would you think how someone else controlled for several different strains of those? So they were isolated in their family.
Right. So, you know, whatever was circulating, so the question was, how can you control for different strains of flu? And you really can't. Basically, what we usually see with flu is that there's one strain circulating in a community at any given time. So whenever you're doing the study, you kind of know what's circulating based on what's in your community at that time. But, you know, what these authors concluded was that actually aerosol transmission was of primary importance, okay? But human studies are sort of fraught with all kinds of problems, which is what you were getting at, in that human beings are not controllable. You know, if you have ever had your doctor tell you to do something and you said, oh, yeah, sure, I'll do that, and then you left the office and you never thought about it again, raise your hand. I mean, we've all done that. We are not controllable beings. So you cannot say that they were washing their hands in the hand hygiene group or that they were wearing masks in the mask group. You can try to do some surrogate markers, like looking at how much hand sanitizer was left in the bottle at the end of the study, or how much soap was left over at the end of the study, or how many masks were gone from the box that they gave the mask group. But that even doesn't give you enough information. I mean, maybe somebody's clever and they took a bunch of masks and threw them out before they turned their box in. Or maybe your thrifty grandma is like, I can wear one mask for a whole week. Like, why would I waste the other 49 masks in the box? Because I can wear the same mask. You know, you can't really know whether the people in these groups are actually doing what you told them to do and the extent to which they're doing it. And so even though we would love to study things in humans as much as possible, humans are basically uncontrollable. So what we do to complement that is do studies in animals. Because animals, their main disadvantage is they're not humans. But you can also control variables a whole lot better than you can when you're taking a human being and setting them out into the wild. Okay? So what I do is I study flu transmission in a couple of different animal models. All right? I study guinea pig transmission, and I also study transmission in ferrets. And you may ask why ferrets doesn't seem like the prototypical lab animal in the way that a guinea pig is, and that is also a long and very interesting story in the history of science that I wish I could get into, but for a long time ferrets have been used in flu transmission studies. And so I use both animal models because I figure, you know, a guinea pig's not a human and a ferret's not a human, but if you get the same result in both animals, maybe you're getting a little closer to the truth about what's true for mammals, and maybe that's also true for humans. So the way that we do these experiments is pretty much the same for both animals. You have some sort of container that you put your animals in, and in the middle of the container, there's an air permeable barrier. And what this barrier does is it lets the air go back and forth between two sides of the cage, but it prevents the animals from touching each other. And so you put one animal on one side and the other animal on the other side, and you infect one of them with the flu. And then what you do is you just wait. And you wait and see, does the flu that animal is exhaling into the environment successfully make it to the other animal?
Do ferrets sneeze?
Ferrets do sneeze. Guinea pigs don't, but ferrets do. And the way that you know if the partner animal got infected is basically by seeing what's in their nose. I mean, we literally will take a guinea pig and or a ferret, and we put them to sleep first because, you know, we don't want them to be too freaked out. And you take a little saline and you just drip it in their nose while they're asleep. Then you have a nice sterile petri dish. I know, the poor dog is like, you do what? You basically, I know, I don't do it to dogs, I promise, no dogs. You basically turn the animal upside down, let the saline drip out of its nose, and then you see if you can grow flu out of what ends up caught in the petri dish. So pretty simple. So what have we learned from these kind of animal studies? Well, this is a study back from 1941 in which these guys did some pretty clever things. What they did is they built these long wooden ducts. And in one end of the duct, they put a wire cage, so open to the air, with a ferret that they had infected with flu. And at the other end of the duct, they put a naive ferret. And then on the side of the duct, what they had was by the infected animal, there was holes in the duct so the air could come in. And then by the naive animal, there was a fan that was blowing air out. So basically what it was doing is sucking air in past the infected ferret, bringing it along the duct, and then venting it out by the naive ferret. And they did this a few times. They did a very long duct, so it was about 5 feet long, so that, you know, the virus had to go basically in a straight path, had to cross 5 feet. They did another duct that was actually 5 feet, but it was bent into an S shape, so that the virus had to go around a curve in order to get to the naive animal. And they even took a U-shaped duct, which was about, I think, 9 feet long in total, so that the virus actually had to make 2 90-degree turns in order to get to the naive animal. And basically, in each of these conditions, the naive animal could get infected. And so what we conclude from this experiment is that, at least in ferrets, flu can be transmitted by aerosols, because that U-shaped duct, it would be really hard for a heavy droplet to make it all the way around. And you know that the ferrets are separated, they can't touch each other, so it can't be by contact. They can't sneeze in each other's faces, so it has to be by aerosol. All right? So that's one of the sort of quintessential flu experiments that suggests that, at least in ferrets, we can transmit flu over long distances, and you don't have to touch. So this was an experiment that was done at Mount Sinai, at my institution. And the question was, why does flu come in the winter? I mean, we sort of take it for granted that wintertime is flu season, but why? So what a colleague of mine did is she took this commercially available environmental chamber, which allows you to regulate temperature and humidity, and she put some guinea pigs in it, in these cages, and I've sort of already showed you this cage, but it's basically just two cages side by side that have, you know, wire grill panels on the side so that air can flow between the cages. You infect one, and you see if the other one gets infected. And she did this experiment over tons of temperature and humidity combinations. And what she found, sort of long story short, is that flu transmits the best when it's cold and dry. And it barely transmitted through the air at all when it's hot. So if it's like 85, 90 degrees, the flu never transmitted. If it was, say, a little bit above freezing and dry, it transmitted like 100% of the time. And then if it was room temperature, that was a little funky because it looked like, you know, there wasn't a straight monotonic relationship between the transmissibility and the humidity. But it was better than it was if it was like 98 degrees outside.
Does that mean that people in, say, Florida or hot countries have not been exposed to flu like we
know? No, so it just means that the transmission is different. The question was, do people who live in Florida or other hot, wet environments not get the flu? And actually, no. People do get the flu. It just transmits differently. It doesn't come in the winter. Say there are parts in the tropics where flu is much more of a year-round thing. There are parts of the world like Hong Kong, which has two annual epidemics, once when it's cold and dry and once when it's warm and wet. So the temperature humidity question is very, very fraught, and a lot of people have tried to figure it out in a lot of different ways. It's more complicated than what I'm saying here. But at least, you know, these data sort of confirm something that we kind of know, which is that flu, at least for us here in New York, likes it when it's cold and dry. That's when we get the flu, okay?
What about the antibodies
against the flu? The question is about what about the immune response in different environments. That's actually a really good question, and that's something I'm looking at right now with some collaborators of mine to see if there's differences in immune responses at different temperatures. We don't know if that's the case, but it's sort of one of the explanations is that the host is different in different environments. Okay, so now this is just a little bit of stuff that I'm doing right now. In collaboration with some engineers, we're trying to sort of bring some physics into the life sciences. And what we're doing is using this sort of, I think I'm running over, but anyway, this complicated laser apparatus, which is kind of cool, that I can't possibly explain to you, but it involves looking at the way that the light is either reflected or refracted off of a droplet that's either water or mostly water. And then you use a high-speed camera to look at the interference patterns of the wavelengths of light as they get either reflected or refracted. And what you can see is, so these are pictures of water droplets made by a humidifier where the guinea pig is. So the more fringes it has, the bigger the droplet is. So even though these droplets, they all look the same size, that's just sort of an artifact. You can actually tell how big they are by counting the fringes. And so the one that has tons of fringes is a big droplet, and the one that has fewer fringes is a small droplet. So we got excited, and we put some guinea pigs into this thing, and this is what we saw. Doesn't look anything like it's supposed to look like. And what we think is that probably it's because the things that are coming out of the guinea pig are not pure enough water, that they're probably a combination of water mixed with other things, mixed with saliva, mixed with respiratory secretions, mixed with cellular debris, that these are sort of semi-solid particles that refract and reflect light differently. And so my engineers are sort of working on the math to see if they can figure out what exactly is going on with these droplets. I'm letting them do that because I don't like math. But hopefully we'll sort of get a sense about what exactly is going between these two cages when we're doing an experiment? And is it really all respiratory, or is it dander, fur, food particles? We don't know what's actually traveling between these two animals when we're doing an experiment. We assume it's respiratory, but we don't know. So another thing we're doing is using some time-lapse photography to figure out what are the guinea pigs doing when they're in an experiment, and does that matter? And what we've seen is using red light, because rodents don't respond to red light very well, so this guinea pig thinks it's dark. But it's light enough that the camera can do some time-lapse photography. And what you can see is the computer basically collapses the guinea pig down into a little white circle. And then it says where the guinea pig is in each of these time-lapse photos and then piles them all on top of each other, and you can sort of see where the animal is based on where all these circles are. So this is an animal that moved around a lot. This is an animal that kind of sat on his butt and didn't do anything, okay? But what you can do is then extract this information and figure out how active was the animal and when were they active. And you can sort of graph it by saying how much how often in a minute was the animal moving versus not moving? And you can sort of, across the time that you're recording, get a measure of their activity level. So this one that was moving a lot was moving, you know, more or less all over, all the time, wasn't really sitting down very much. And when we measured the actual, every time one of these particles would trip the laser and would take a picture, how many times we actually saw something going between the two cages, okay? Now, what about the animal that was sort of more of a sloth? So what you can see is this animal had times when she was really just chilling, and she wasn't doing anything. And you can see that the particles that trip the laser are exactly when the animal's moving. So we don't know what it means yet. Does it mean that it's dander? And you know, every time the animal moves, a little poof of dander comes off, and that's what we're measuring? Is it because when they're moving, their respiratory rate increases and they're breathing more? We don't know. But we're starting to use, I think, some of the techniques that engineers and physicists have developed to try to understand a very complicated biological process like flu. And I think that's it. So I will take any questions that anyone has.
I might have listened when you said it, but in the temperature humidity study, did they look at whether or not it affected different strains of food?
So the question is, in the temperature and humidity studies, did they look at different strains of flu? So the graph I showed you was one strain, okay? I have done a lot of different strains, and I can tell you that the same pattern is observable in that when it's cold and dry, it transmits really well, and when it's warm, it doesn't. So that's true for different influenza A strains, so like H3N2 or H1N1, if those sound familiar to anybody. It's true for influenza B. That same general pattern holds.
Are there certain people who tend to get, are there certain people who tend to get the flu all the time?
Well, we know that people who are immunosuppressed definitely are more susceptible. So the thing about the flu is once you've gotten it, you have a bit of an immune protection from it for a little while. Now, the flu is very good at sort of mutating itself and becoming something that your immune system no longer recognizes, and so then you can get it again. I'm not sure if there's any data looking at how often immunocompetent people get the flu. I mean, that's a question.
In your household study, you said that you have a flu season with possibly one strain of the main track. Is that really known? And with the advent of Oxford Nanopore sequencing, do you think this will kind of increase the the detection of mutation rates in influenza, like if they're fully Ebola?
Yeah, so the question is, like, in something like a household study, do you really know that it's the same strain that's circulating in a community? Like, we don't know down to the household level, for example, because flu does mutate all the time. But there's actually a really big global surveillance network of flu all around the world, northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere, tropics. They're always collecting flu strains and sequencing them and seeing, is it the same as it has been? Is it different? And there's a lot of plasticity in the flu genome. So it's always different and yet sort of the same. It's kind of a complicated question.
Let's do one more question.
Okay.
Does the flu ever mutate while you have it, like over the time you have it?
It does indeed. So does the flu mutate in you, okay? It actually does. And that's sort of an evolutionary thing where flu is an RNA virus, and RNA polymerases, the enzyme that makes RNA, is notoriously unfaithful. So it constantly puts in wrong nucleotides at a much higher level than a DNA polymerase does. And so flu actually exists in what we call quasi-species, which are, you know, each strain probably has one little mutation in a different place than another one. And so if you're infected with a million flu particles, you probably have like 100,000 different genotypes in you. But each of those genotypes is not going to be equally fit. So, you know, some will rise to the top and be fitter and be able to transmit better. Others are not going to be able to do their job quite as well, and they'll die an evolutionary death. And so, but yeah, I mean, it is constantly changing, even in a single host. And I think I'm being cut off. Thank you, you've been a great, thanks.
Thank you so much, Nicole, that was amazing.